أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Once again, welcome to A String of Pearls, A Thematic Flow of the Quran by Igna Sisters. I've got great news for you today. First, we're going to be covering Surah Ibrahim, Surah Hijr, Surah Nahl, and after today, we'll have gone through almost half of the Quran. Alhamdulillah. Secondly, the Prophet ﷺ said, how excellent the affair of the believer. His affair, all of it, is good for him. And this is not the case with anyone except the believer. If prosperity comes to him, he is thankful to God. And if adversity falls on him, he perseveres patiently. So it is all good for him. Isn't that so comforting? In any kind of a case, a believer who is grateful and patient will find goodness in all of their affairs. SubhanAllah. I share that with you because the theme of today's surahs is going to be gratitude, inshallah. So in the last surahs, we learned about patience, a beautiful patience, sabrun jameel, right? With Yusuf alayhi salam, Yaqub alayhi salam, you know, the previous prophets, as well as from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam himself. And we discussed that patience is required in order to persevere in the path of truth. Then we also mentioned toward the end of the last recording that human beings find the most contentment in the submission to one Allah, in accepting Tawheed. When we balance ourselves on the scale of hope and fear in our actions, naturally we find sakina of our hearts in doing what we are created for. It is in our human fitrah to submit ourselves to Allah. And you all know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already taken that covenant of alest from us, right? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathered all of his creation and asked, am I not your Rabb? And we all confirmed, bala shahidna, right? That we attest to the fact that Allah is our Rabb. And we come into this world already having that promise made to Allah. So it's already microchipped in us. Our heart is programmed that way. So if you look at an example of a computer, if you reset a computer, it goes back to its default settings, right? Well, our default setting is the belief in Tawheed. But here's the problem. Shaitan is a virus for our hearts. And you know what happens if your software catches a virus? The virus itself, that it starts to replicate and starts to implant its own code throughout the rest of the programs in the computer. And that way, the entire system gets infected. And I actually looked this up on a technical website, and I found it so interesting that the virus writers, the people who make these viruses, they use social engineering deceptions to trap people. And that term refers to like a psychological manipulation of people into performing actions that may not be beneficial for them. So it's like a social influence that aims to change the behavior or perception of others through indirect, deceptive, or underhanded tactics. So that's what they do. It's clickbait, right? They create links or they create emails with pictures or files, you know, anything that seems attractive enough or interesting enough for people to click on it. And when people do that, they follow through what they were enticed with, and then their device gets infected. So Shaitan is literally a virus for our hearts. He whispers these enticing things in our ears. He makes these things look attractive, and then we end up, you know, following through. And actually, my husband works in cybersecurity, and there are so many antivirus programs out there that are, you know, constantly being updated and upgraded, and people buy them to protect their computers or electronic devices, right? Yet we leave our hearts wide open, subhanAllah. And you know, sometimes when a virus comes in and starts to spread, the screen goes dark or it gets grainy, right? And everything starts to malfunction. And so you have to reboot that entire system and you have to reset to factory settings and all of that. And if it's a smart virus, then you've got to sometimes take extra steps too, right? You have to read the manual. You have to learn the tricks of the virus itself in order to clean your computer and then protect it. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts Surah Ibrahim by saying, O Muhammad, this is a book which we have revealed to you so that you may bring mankind out of utter darkness to the light. SubhanAllah. You want anti-shaytan protection? This is the book. And so we will see the mention of shaitan in all of these three surahs coming up because, like we said, you know, we'll be discussing gratitude and that's the theme of these surahs. And shaitan, from all of the creation of Allah, is the biggest ingrate, right? We all know that. So we have to study his behavior and his deceptive tactics, and then figure out ways to seek protection of Allah so that, you know, he doesn't outsmart us, because he is very smart, right? And so this also goes back to Surah Ra'd, the previous surah, where we said that the central idea of that surah was that Allah is sufficient as a witness that this is the Prophet, this is the book of guidance, and the rest of the creation of Allah already does what it's supposed to do, right? Willingly or by compulsion. So if we choose not to obey, if we choose to deny the authority of Allah, then Allah doesn't need us anyway. Right? We need this book in order to take us from darkness into light. And it's going to be our loss if we turn away. And it is our success if we turn toward Allah. So now in Surah Ibrahim, you know, which was revealed around the same time as the previous surahs, it's revealed towards the end stages of Mecca, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding the Quraysh that we sent you a prophet who speaks your own language. Right? And every Rasul came to speak clearly to his own people and in their own language. So now if you are being warned with punishment, it's because you're the one that keeps denying the messenger. And at the end of the day, Allah doesn't need you. You need him, right? And then a little later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, remember how Musa was sent to his people to take them out of darkness into light. And he told his people to remember the blessings of Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you are grateful, then I will definitely increase you. لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. For sure I will increase you. But if you show ingratitude, then my punishment is severe. Now, when we talk about gratitude, right, it's also an expression of worship, right? Just like patience is, just like hope is, like the fear of Allah's punishment is, like reflection on the Quran is, there are many ways to gain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And worship can be in many forms. And gratitude is one of them, where we recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's favor and blessings upon us, and we worship Him out of that gratitude, that humility, that reverence, and that show of true dependence on Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So therefore, ingratitude or being ungrateful is denying the authority of Allah. And so that is the definition of kufr, disbelief, right? So in ayah number 21, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the weak among the people will ask the elite that we followed you. We did what you were doing. We followed the trends that you told us were cool. And now can you save us from the punishment of Allah? And these influencers will say that we had we been guided, then we would have guided you too. You chose to follow us. Now there's no point in this blame game, right? And this is so scary if you think about it. If any of you have Instagram, does this sound familiar? I mean, there are literally thousands of these so-called influencers out there, and they have millions of followers. And they're telling people what's trendy, what's best, what's in, what to wear, what to eat, where to go, what to buy. It's like they show up on a screen and people want to have everything that they have. What are you wearing? Where can I get it from? What are you eating? Where can I find it? And it's like a rat race, right? To see who has the best stuff. And what ends up happening is that people start to feel like they don't have as nice as stuff as everybody else. They don't have as fun of a life as others. Because once you start comparing yourself to others, then you'll never be satisfied with what you have, right? Because if someone or another, if you look into their lives, someone or another will always have more or better or fancier things than you. And so people will start to complain and find faults in their own lives. And instead of being grateful for what we have, we start to be ungrateful because everything that we don't have and everybody else has, right? And whether that stuff is good for us or not, it doesn't matter. So this is all a trick of shaitan. And we have to be careful. You know those Instagram pages? They're called feeds. And so we have to be careful what we're subconsciously feeding ourselves from that. And because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if you are grateful, I will for sure give you more. So focus on what we have, right? And be grateful for that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will put barakah in it so that we are content, that we are fulfilled, and we're not looking to fill ourselves with other things. Because if there's no barakah, no matter how much we collect of this dunya, it will never satisfy us. And that's what shaitan does. He makes promises, right? And he just keeps us busy trying to collect the dunya. And eventually the greed gets so far beyond our control that people try, you know, they turn to impermissible ways to get what they want, subhanAllah. So in the next ayah, we see the actual shaitan confessing to this. In ayah number 22, we see that, You know, as the people of the hellfire are about to enter their punishment, Shaitan will speak up and he will basically say, listen guys, the promises that Allah made to you were all true. I made you some promises too, but Allah spoke the truth and I admit I lied about everything. So now all of a sudden he's Mr. Honesty, right? And then he'll say what Allah has already told us, right? That I didn't have any authority over you. I didn't make you follow me. I just whispered. I just enticed. I just nudged. And you pressed that follow button. I clickbaited and you fell for it. So you did whatever you did yourself. So don't try to point fingers at me. You can blame yourself today. I'm not helping you and you can't help me anyway. And on top of that, he says, I disbelieve in your act of shirk with Allah today. I reject it. And for sure, wrongdoers are about to see a painful punishment. Isn't that so infuriating? Like, are you for real? I mean, it's so mind-boggling how we get into the tricks of Shaitan. And then this is what he ends up doing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already told us this, right? And you know those people that are like hurling shoes at the Jamarat during Hajj? Even though that's not okay to do, because we do what we do in those pillars of Hajj because of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? So we have to follow what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did. But I guess those feelings of like, you know, just hatred towards Shaitan come from becoming closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the other worships that that are required in Hajj. But realizing how much of a fraud Shaitan really is, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is already telling us this, how insincere this loser Shaitan is. And he deserves none of our attention, none, right? So that's why we've been told that if we feel that waswasa, if we feel that desire to do something that we know is not right, even the littlest things, right? Our conscience would always tell us. And we know when we're not supposed to be doing something. And so at that time, to seek protection of Allah, say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. This is a dua for protection, right? So if we seek it, Allah will provide that protection in that moment. And we learned this from Yusuf alayhi salam, remember? When immediately he sought protection from committing a sin. Also, there's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam when once a sahabi was traveling with him and all of a sudden the companion's horse begins acting up and he tries to throw the sahabi off. And so the companion goes, may Allah curse Shaitan. Meaning that Shaitan is the one who scared the horse and he's acting this way. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he heard that and he told him, don't mention Shaitan because he gets a big head thinking that you attributed something to him. Instead, you know, instead of mentioning him, mention Allah to make Shaitan feel even more insignificant. So you should say Bismillah instead. And we've seen our elders do that, right? That's, you know, that's where I learned it from. If a child tripped or, you know, falls, I remember my mom going, Bismillah, Bismillah, right? But now we know why. And so when we attach that sincere intention to remember Allah and reject Shaitan with it, it becomes even more meaningful, subhanAllah. And because remembering Allah is a form of protection in all its forms too, dhikr in itself is a form of protection from Shaitan. As a hadith of the Prophet it says, dhikr is a fortress of a believer. And so the scholars mentioned that those who do frequent dhikr, Shaitan has less access to them. And so making sure we do the morning and evening adhkar every day, and the ones after the fard prayer, subhanAllah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, and the regular adhkar for like eating and sleeping and going outside, all of those. And then of course, the Quran itself is dhikr. So having a strong, consistent relationship with the Quran, all of this can become a means of protecting ourselves from the evils of Shaitan. And then another great form of protection is being in the company of righteous people. The Prophet ﷺ said, Shaitan is farther away from two people and he's closer to one person. Meaning that when we're alone, it's easy for Shaitan to influence us. But when we're in the company of righteous people, then Shaitan has less access to us. And we are ourselves, we find it easier to be good in good company, right? And every time I think of this example, I think about, you know, just being out in the mall, you know, as we all do, especially in the West or like a majority non-Muslim country. You know, when you're out and about and you're walking, but as soon as I see another hijabi sister, I have this impulse to fix my scarf. I don't know what it is, but I always do that. And it's like a gentle reminder to be, you know, just to be aware, right? So naturally we end up being better. We end up doing better things, being more God conscious if we find ourselves with those people who remind us of Allah, right? Rather than those that make us forget. And because right after this speech of Shaitan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a beautiful example of a tree of Iman. of a good word being like a good tree, whose roots are firm and the branches high in the sky. They yield fruits and bring benefit to the people. And then, of course, the opposite of that is a weak and evil tree that is uprooted from the surface of earth, having no stability. Obviously, as Muslims, we should be like the good tree, right? Strong roots and high branches and beneficial to everyone. But also, for a good tree to grow in that way, that tree needs to get its nutrition from the roots, right? And the roots pull it from the surrounding soil. If the surroundings are not healthy and they lack the proper nutrition, then the tree cannot grow as high and as tall and much less benefit anyone else, right? So we have to think about where our roots are planted too. Who are we surrounding ourselves with? Whether that environment is conducive to us building that fruitful tree of Iman or not, right? With the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why good company and our environment are so, so important. And because in that case, you know, even if shaitan does sway our branches from time to time, then we have a strong foundation and we have a strong support system to help us not break altogether. We can recover with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah. And then moving on in Surah Ibrahim, the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam comes. And this is the prophet that is the epitome of gratitude. And this is the surah where the prophet Ibrahim is mentioned leaving his wife and child in a barren land, making dua for them and his progeny. And the prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam is the fulfillment of this dua of our father Ibrahim alayhi salam, who is now a messenger in this previously barren city. And you know, that's now been established. And the very people that inhabit the city are now betraying the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam and rejecting the prophet that is trying to bring them back to the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam, subhanAllah. So from there, we move on to Surah Hijr. Surah Hijr was revealed around the same time as Surah Ibrahim. And it's sort of like a pair with Surah Ibrahim, where it's the same idea that we saw in Surah An'am and Al-A'raf, and then also in Surah Yunus and Surah Hud, and now Surah Ibrahim and Surah Hijr. They come in pairs. So what happened is where there was advice first, and then the stern warning came with the consequences after that. So hope and fear, right? So in this surah again, the Quran is mentioned by its name, and some of the most important verses about the Quran are revealed too. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun." Surely we have revealed this reminder and we will surely preserve it ourselves. And this idea is also very similar to what we saw in Surah Ra'd and Surah Ibrahim too, that this is the truth, we revealed it to the Prophet and we will preserve it, whether you want to believe in it or not. And from the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets the tone of the surah saying that the day will come when the unbelievers will wish that they were Muslims. Leave them alone to eat and enjoy themselves and be deluded by false hopes, for soon they will find out the truth. And like we've seen throughout the Makki surahs in the Quran, that the mentions of heaven and the earth and the creation and the ridicule of the messenger and tidbits of stories of the previous nations, all of this is also mentioned in Surah Hijr as well. After that, the story of Adam alayhi salam and Iblis, the shaitan, comes, but a different aspect of it in this surah. And I read a beautiful reflection on this, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes how he created man from clay and mud, and then once he molded him into shape and then breathed his soul into Adam alayhi salam, and then the angels were told to prostrate. In essence, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that until the soul was breathed into Adam alayhi salam, the body itself was not worthy of the respect of prostration to him. Meaning without our soul, we're of no value. We're just flesh, right? Our worth and our value comes from our soul. And obviously that too, according to how much of our soul is upon the divine guidance. How much do we fulfill that purpose of our soul? And so think about, you know, how much do we take care of our souls and compared to how much we take care of our bodies? We're all so concerned about the flesh part, but what about the soul, right? If we're stripping our soul of its fitrah, then obviously we're taking away from our own worth too, right? We have to think about that. And it's following this divine guidance that gives us any value at all, subhanAllah. So then when asked to prostrate, Iblis basically becomes arrogant and ungrateful. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends his curse upon him, to which he says, "Oh my Rabb, give me respite until the day of judgment." This saying of shaitan itself is so scary to me. Yani, he still believes in Allah and the oneness of Allah. He still believes in the hereafter. What gets him cursed and doomed is his arrogance, that he thinks he's better than someone else. That's it. And how many of us fit in that criteria, subhanAllah? We believe in Allah. We believe in the hereafter. But watch us judge every other person so easily, right? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness and humility. Ameen. So shaitan asks for some time and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go ahead, but know that you have no control over my sincere servants except those misguided ones who follow you. Now remember, in the last surah, shaitan confirmed that he doesn't have any authority over us. He said it himself, and that he only whispers and makes suggestions to us. He only offers clickbait, right? And we do the following of him. It's on us. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that my sincere servants won't follow you. Only the misguided ones will. And so that's basically shaitan's policy. He knows that human beings need fulfillment from somewhere. Our hearts are made like that. So if we don't find it in the submission to Allah, in the worship of Allah, our hearts will try to find it somewhere else. And that's where we open the door for shaitan to attack. So then, you know, if we're not busying ourselves in the remembrance of Allah, then it has to be somewhere else, right? Maybe too much shopping, maybe too much Netflixing, maybe keeping up with the Joneses, or maybe keeping an eye on the Chaudhrys. Right? Anything. We'll be occupied somewhere or another. But how much of that is helping us in the akhirah? That's the question. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our hearts firm and sincere on His deen. Ameen. So Surah Hijr continues to mention the different aspects of the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the story of Lut, the people of Thamud, and also the people of Hijr, the rocky track people. These people used to carve their houses in mountains, and they would feel secure in those houses, thinking that the house will protect them. Yani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that blessed them with the strength and skill and idea to build the houses. And instead of being grateful and recognizing this favor of Allah, they denied their messenger and his call to the truth. And then they said, we're already so powerful. We're already so skillful. We're already so awesome. Why would we need to follow you to be successful? We already got it made, right? So no thanks. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, none of those houses or anything that they used to boast about saved them from the punishment. Subhanallah. So this surah ends with recognizing the pain that the Prophet ﷺ used to feel when the Quraysh used to make fun of him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And they also made fun of the companions as well, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala consoles the Prophet ﷺ and tells him, if you want this hardship to end, if you want to get through this rough time, then فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَكُمْ مِنَ السَّاجِدِينَ. Then glorify the praises of your Rabb and be of those who prostrate themselves before Him. And worship your Rabb until there comes to you that which is certain. SubhanAllah. This is the opposite of what shaitan did. He didn't prostrate. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, if you should prostrate and you should remember Allah and fill your heart up with the contentment of worship, and don't leave your heart empty for shaitan to come and fulfill it with something else until death comes to you. So that's the formula. And that's what we have to do as well, right? And then we move on to Surah Nahl. Now in Surah Hijr, where we learned about the people of Hijr and how they use their strength and their resources, not to be grateful to Allah, but to deny the authority of Allah. And they'd also say, go ahead, bring the punishment. We can hide in our mountain homes, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins Surah Nahl by saying that Allah's command is on its way, so don't seek to hasten it. So first of all, Allah decides when the punishment comes. It won't come when you're asking for it. And second of all, you feel so secure in your homes in the mountains. You think you're so special that you have these things? You're not. Because everything that Allah created is subjected to you anyway. The night and the day have been subjected for our service. Right? The animals and the benefits and the food and the warmth that they provide, it's all been created for us. Every creation of Allah is there to serve us. So it's not that, you know, you're so special that you have this. It is from the mercy and the favor of Allah that we get anything at all, right? And these are just the things that we see. There are workings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we don't even see, or we don't even know that they exist, right? And how perfect you know, everything works in harmony to sustain us, subhanAllah, and how it makes it easy for us to exist and continue to live and function properly. You know, just things like gravity and oxygen, and on a much smaller scale, our own cell structure. If one cell multiplies differently in our body, then it turns into cancer, and that can kill us. Yet most of us continue to live because each and every cell and every neuron in our body does what it's supposed to do. And without any effort on our part, that's Allah, right? And think about it. How does this universe not just collapse, and how come we don't all get sucked into the black hole? Who is keeping this balance? And from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, we know that even the fish in the sea are making dua of forgiveness for the ones who are on the path of seeking knowledge or on the path of goodness, right? So first of all, Allah created fish so that we can eat it. And the ones we haven't eaten yet, they're there to make dua for us. SubhanAllah. It's so amazing to think how insignificant we are just by ourselves. Yet when we follow our fitrah and when we live our lives meaningfully for the purpose that we are created for, then the entire rest of the creation of Allah starts to serve us in ways we don't even know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 18, if you want to count the favors of Allah, you will never be able to count them. Surely Allah is forgiving and merciful. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, you have no idea how many favors of Allah you have no idea they even exist. But it's okay, because Allah is the most forgiving. He doesn't need us to count every single favor of Him. Right? What He does expect us to do is recognize that this incredible system of favors exists from Him for us. And so we have to show gratitude for it. And that means submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's authority and not associating other false deities with Him, right? Because they can never be equal to Him. So worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a one true Lord, because that's the least that we can do. SubhanAllah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also focuses on the creation of the honeybee, An-Nahl, and how small of a creature it is, and how miraculously it serves its purpose. And it's for the benefit of us again, right? And what's also interesting is that if you look at the honeybees, when they eat honey from like a little pool of honey, you'll notice that they'll eat from the corner. They'll come and sit on the corner. They never land on top of the honey and start devouring it down. Because if they do that, they'll know that they get stuck and they'll die. So there's an important lesson that we learn from it too, that yes, this world is made for our benefit. We are allowed to benefit from the halal provisions of this world. But we shouldn't indulge ourselves so much in it that we get trapped and aren't able to pull ourselves away. You know, because it's not worth it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 95, certainly Allah's reward is far better than all of your gain, if you but knew it. Whatever is with you is transitory, and what is with Allah is everlasting. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions shaitan again in this surah, just like in the previous surahs. And, you know, this time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is confirming again that shaitan has no authority over Allah's servant, those who believed and those who relied upon their Lord. So shaitan might come to us to entice us with material things of this world, and again, finding fulfillment somewhere else, right? But those who depend on their Lord and trust Allah will not fall to the authority of shaitan. So Surah An-Nahl ends by giving the etiquettes of inviting people to Islam with wisdom and in a courteous manner. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a reminder to be patient in difficult times and know that Allah is with those who adopt a righteous attitude. So the theme of these surahs was gratitude. And throughout the surahs, we saw that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave example upon example of why the attitude of gratitude is necessary. It's a necessary part of our submission to Allah. And it's beneficial for us too in this world and the next. Because, you know, if you just want to look at the secular research, there are a mountain of studies that show the benefit of gratitude. Yani, it makes you healthier, it makes you more generous, it reduces stress, it makes you a better sleeper at night. You know, and one study actually found out that keeping a gratitude journal reduced stress an average of 28% for healthcare workers. So just acknowledging our thankfulness, like verbally or in our actions or spelling it out to ourselves by writing it down every night. It has tangible results, subhanAllah. So we should actually be very thankful just for the fact that gratitude in itself is so effective for our well-being. And at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it a way to get closer to Him as well. So it's a win-win situation, right? And of course, couple that with the command of showing patience in the end of Surah Nahl, and we have a formula for success, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow on us from His boundless treasures of mercy and favors, and allow us to always be His grateful servants. Ameen. Wa akhru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.